This conference will now be recorded.
Hello, good morning, one and all. How many of you have come? 58. 58 have come. Hello, shall we start or we will wait? CR? 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 Hello? Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
Shall we start? It is already 9:12. Only 66 of you are there. Okay, in one more minute we will start. Ask your friends to log in. So today we will be dealing with two topics. One is shock in children. Second one is anaphylaxis. Okay. Previously, did you hear of shock in children or adults? One of you can answer, no? Hello? CR. Roll number 75. Roll number 75. Hello. At least are you able to hear? Are you able to hear?
Yes, sir.
So what is shock? Shock is defined as blood pressure less than systemic, systolic blood pressure, systemic, even both diastolic and this, but mainly systolic blood pressure less than 5th centile of age normal. Uncontrolled fluid loss or blood loss associated with tachycardia and hypotension with acidosis and increased lactate levels, signs of organ multi-organ dysfunction with decreased urine output, altered mental status. Okay, pediatric shock, will be dealing with definition, what it is and what is not, pathophysiology, recognition, management. So if you take, heart is a pump and these are the pipes, blood vessels are the pipes. One is arterial side, other one is venous side. This is the peripheral site of gaseous exchange at the tissue level. Okay, understood. So pediatric shock, cellular pathology has nothing to do with blood pressure until very late stages, along with cardiac output and heart rate. Okay, inability to meet the metabolic demand is oxygen supply and metabolite supply to the tissues, or inability to supply oxygen to the cell, or inability of the cell to use oxygen, like in cyanide poisoning. Supply demand imbalance will be existing in shock. A hemodynamic abnormality that leads to inability to meet the tissue metabolic demands. Okay, it is a dynamic and progressive process. A systemic reduction in tissue perfusion and decrease the tissue oxygen delivery. Shift to aerobic to anaerobic metabolism, which is a less efficient metabolism and 20-fold less synthesis of ATP. ATP is, we know, powerhouse of cell or mitochondria, and mitochondria generates ATP, which is very much required for respiratory chain and respiratory transport. Leads to metabolic, that is lactic acidosis. Over time, if shock is not treated, cell membrane ion pump dysfunction occurs, cellular edema occurs, leakage of cell contents, that is sodium, calcium inside, inadequate regulation of intracellular pH, finally cell death and organ failure, cardiac arrest and death may occur. It is a dynamic process which is progressive and with changing physiology, requires bedside management. Oxygen deficiency should be immediately corrected and energy uncoupling also should be dealt with. So evidence of, what are the signs and symptoms of shock? Evidence of end organ hypoperfusion, like if kidneys are hypoperfused, there will be reduced urine output. Brain is hyperperfused, altered mental status will be there. And poor perfusion, so poor peripheral circulation. Okay, that leads to prolonged capillary filling time and cold peripheries. Metabolic dysfunction, which is due to lactic acidosis, because cell functions will occur at certain pH, physiologic pH. If it is less than that, it is called acidosis, and metabolic function of the cells will be altered. So altered metabolic demands. Shock, feel the feet, look at the neck. So tachycardia, non-specific but early sign is tachycardia. Skin changes, prolonged capillary refill time due to vasoconstriction, because whenever there is shock, peripheral circulatory system will think that there is underfilling of arterial vessels, so there will be reflex vasoconstriction, which leads to compensation of shock to certain extent, following which it will not compensate if we don't treat it early. So flash refill with early distributive shock and with irreversible shock, it will go into irreversible shock if you don't treat it. Pallor, even though hemoglobin is fine, if patient is having severe vasoconstriction, then pallor can occur. Okay, impaired mental status, fuzzy, irritable or sleepy, and sometimes comatose in late phases of shock. Oliguria, because hyperperfusion of kidney. Hypotension, if you have not treated it early, then you have missed your ball, so it will be progressively, that is called decompensated shock. Okay, there will be initially wide pulse pressure in case of distributive shock and aortic insufficiency. What are the compensatory mechanisms? Due to baroreceptors, I think you heard of these baroreceptors, chemoreceptors in physiology. Baroreceptors in aortic arch and carotid sinus. Low mean arterial pressure cause vasoconstriction, because they will think that there is underfilling of arterial vessels, so there will be vasoconstriction, and there will be, it tries to increase blood pressure, cardiac output and heart rate. These are the compensatory mechanisms through baroreceptors. Through chemoreceptors, what will happen? Respond to cellular acidosis, because chemoreceptors are pH changes, they detect pH changes, results in vasoconstriction and respiratory stimulation, so that they want to wash out that acid, respiratory tachypnea will occur and tries to increase blood pressure by vasoconstriction. Renin angiotensin aldosterone system, I think you have already heard of this system in kidney. Due to decreased renal perfusion, which leads to angiotensin causing vasoconstriction and aldosterone causing salt and water retentions. Okay, so whenever there is hyperperfusion to kidney, RAS, renin angiotensin aldosterone system will activate, which causes reflex vasoconstriction and aldosterone. Aldosterone in turn leads to salt and water retention, so that it will try to increase, because body is thinking there is, the arterial system is underfilled with water or blood or fluid, whatever it is, so it tries to retain fluid. Humoral responses through catecholamine release, like dopamine, endogenous dopamine release. Autotransfusion, reorientation of extracellular fluid, because whenever there is acute deficiency of intracellular, some extracellular fluid enters into intravascular compartment and tries to compensate it. These are the various compensatory mechanisms during shock. So what are the clinical signs of hemorrhagic shock in children with varying degrees of blood loss? So if you take the percentage of blood loss less than 15%, 15 to 25%, 25 to 40% and more than 40%, this is very significant, because 25 to 40% heart rate is maximally increased, blood pressure is decreased, capillary refill time is very much prolonged, respiratory rate is moderately tachypneic, and decreased urine output is decreased less than 0.5 ml per kg per hour, and mental status is anxious, confused. If you miss the ball here, the child may progress into decompensated shock, that is more than 40% blood loss. It must initially increase, heart rate may drop later, blood pressure may decrease, and prolonged capillary filling time, severe tachypnea and respiratory arrest may occur. Urine output is completely absent, confused, lethargic, unresponsive, comatose. So we should be treating the shock, recognizing the shock early and treat the shock early. Okay. stages of shock. Initial, I told you, compensated shock due to compensatory mechanisms, uncompensated shock if compensatory mechanisms fail, and to irreversible shock. So compensated shock, what will happen? Initially, we already discussed it. Stroke volume and heart rate will increase. So ultimately, cardiac output is a multiplication of heart rate into stroke volume. So cardiac output increases and systemic vascular resistance also increases, which works to keep blood pressure within normal limits. But there is limit for everything. So it will not compensate beyond a point. Tachycardia, decreased pulses, and cool extremities in cold shock, flushing and bounces in warm shock. Okay, you always remember, if the peripheries are warm, you should think of warm shock. If shock in the presence of warm peripheries, it is warm shock, most probably septic shock, distributive shock. And if it is cold peripheries, then it is cold shock. Oliguria may have a lactic acidosis also associated. Uncompensated shock, compensatory mechanisms are overwhelmed beyond a point, they will not compensate. So hypotension will occur, altered mental status will occur, increased lactic acidosis, and generally quick progression to cardiac arrest because cardiac muscle is one of the very much highly metabolically active muscle, and myocardium is having so much of mitochondria, and it requires constant supply of ATP and calcium. If due to lactic acidosis, cells may not be able to utilize this oxygen, calcium, because pH is altered, myocardial depression occurs, later cardiac arrest also will occur. Okay, so irreversible shock, irreversible organ damage, cardiac arrest, and death will occur when uncompensated shock is finally progress into irreversible shock. So we should act quickly and think slowly, okay, because we should be ascertaining a cause to the shock, but shock should be treated immediately. So we should be acting immediately whenever there is compensatory mechanisms. We should be acting. We should not allow the child to progress to uncompensated or irreversible phases of shock. If he progress to irreversible shock, he will be dying only. So this is American College of Critical Care Medicine hemodynamic definitions of shock. So cold or warm shock, this perfusion manifests by altered decreased mental status, capillary refill time more than 2 seconds in cold shock, or flash capillary refill in warm shock, diminished cold shock, or bounding in case of warm shock, peripheral pulses, okay, moderate cooled extremities in case of cold shock, or decreased urine output less than 1 ml per kg per hour. Fluid refractory bar, Doppman resistant shock is one thing. Shock persists despite more than or equal to 60 ml per kg per day, fluid resuscitation and Doppman infusion of 10 mics per kg per minute. So if child is not responding to this, we will call it as fluid refractory bar, Doppman resistant shock. What is catecholamine resistant shock? Shock persists despite use of the direct acting catecholamine like epinephrine or norepinephrine. Refractory shock, it will not respond to any kind of treatment. Shock persists despite the goal directed use of inotropes like epinephrine, norepinephrine, vasopressors, vasodilators, and maintenance of metabolic demands like glucose, calcium, and hormonal balance is also maintained, but still shock is not responding. It is called as refractory shock. Okay, so we should be adding steroids during this time. Okay, hydrocortisone is also given but not responding, is completely refractory shock. Types of shock, if you take hypovolemic shock, cardiogenic shock, distributive shock, and obstructive shock, 4 varieties. In this hypovolemic, the hemorrhagic is one variety, and in distributive, septic is most common variety. So classification of shock, hypovolemic shock decreases preload, that is due to blood loss or fluid loss from the intravascular compartment, which leads to decreased preload due to internal or external losses. Cardiogenic shock, because pump is failing, heart is failing, so decreased cardiac output and systolic function. Distributive shock, decrease in systemic vascular resistance with abnormal distribution of blood flow, that is peripheral pooling of blood will occur in distributive shock. Functional hypovolemia, because already fluid is there in the intravascular compartment, but vascular tree has accommodating more and more because of vasodilatation, that is functional hypovolemia, decreased preload, and typically this cardiac output. And obstructive shock due to outflow from the left side of the heart or right side of the heart due to obstruction that occurs in the heart area. Okay, it is outlet obstruction. So if you take age based criteria for systolic blood pressure to call it hypotension, that is the fifth sentence, 0 to 28 days, it is less than 60 mm per mm of Hg. 1 month to 12 months of age, it is less than 70 mm of Hg. 1 to 10 years, it is 70 plus less than 70 plus or plus two times of age. And if it is more than 10 years of age, less than 90 is the cutoff. Okay. Parameters for normal blood pressure and hypotension in this age group. And the thresholds for heart rate and mean arterial pressure is term newborn 120 to 180 with a mean arterial pressure of 55. Up to 1 year, it is 60. Up to 2 years, it is 65. 7 years is also 65. 15 years is also 65 is the mean arterial pressure. Okay. Types of shock, we already discussed hypovolemic shock. What will happen? Mechanism of circulatory failure, volume depletion, absolute or relative decrease, leading to decreased cardiac output and increase in systemic vascular resistance. We already discussed systemic vascular resistance tries to maintain BP to certain extent. Signs and symptoms are tachycardia, because to increase the output, cardiac output, diminished pulses, sunken eyes, because fluid is lost, blood loss or fluid loss, and fontanelles are depressed, and oliguria, because kidney is not getting enough perfusion, prolonged capillary refill time. How do we treat it? It is only fluid is less, we will give fluid, crystalloid bolus, normal saline or RL, usually normal saline, until hemodynamics improve. 20 ml per kg to a maximum extent of 60 ml per kg per day, we discussed already, so not day, 60 ml per kg. Reassess after each bolus, blood products in hemorrhagic shock. Cardiogenic shock, because heart is the problem here, cardiac output and will decrease, and systemic vascular tries to maintain BP. Signs and symptoms, tachycardia, diminished pulses, hepatomegaly, because right side of the heart, if it is affected, finally, there will be hepatomegaly and jugular venous distension. Inotropic agents like dopamine, dobutamine, epinephrine, milrinone can be tried. Small volume boluses, because already volume is overloaded and heart is failing, so we should not overload with fluids. Small volume boluses of 5 to 10 ml per kg per day we should be using, might be administered carefully while monitoring response. Get echo early and consider prostaglandin E1 infusion. Type of shock, distributive anaphylactic neurogenic shock. Okay, in distributive shock we have anaphylactic and neurogenic. So anaphylaxis is one of the form of distributive shock, remember this. Okay, and sepsis is also a distributive shock. So mechanism is the increase in cardiac tries to maintain, and but systemic vascular resistance decrease because peripheral vasodilatation occurs in this. Signs and symptoms, angioedema, respiratory distress, stridor, wheezing, hypotension occurs. Okay, what are the interventions? We have to start adrenergic support immediately while giving fluids as well. Okay, obtain a vascular access early, and supratherapeutic doses of inotropes might be required because it is an anaphylactic shock and neurogenic shock. We should give more doses. Cardiac output may be normal and systemic vascular resistance may decrease. Hypotension in the absence of tachycardia are the signs and symptoms. And interventions, we have to support systemic vascular resistance with vasopressors. Okay, because systemic vascular resistance is down, we should support with vasopressors. Phenylephrine might be required. Give fluids as necessary. Obstructive shock, we already thought preload will be reduced and cardiac output is reduced. So systemic vascular resistance will be normal or increased. Tachycardia will occur, hypotension, jugular venous distension, tracheal deviation of pneumothorax is present, equalization of pressures with elevated CVP if invasive monitoring in place. Okay, so what will happen? Intervention rapidly, fatally, if underlying process is not corrected, recognized and reversed. Fluid boluses should be given while preparation is done for emergency drainage of this pneumothorax or whatever is compressing the causing obstructive shock. Okay, septic shock is described separately. It is a form of distributive shock. Okay, warm shock, we call it as warm shock because periphery systemic vascular resistance is down, vasodilatation will occur and there will be warmness in the periphery. But initially cardiac output may increase, but once it progresses to cold shock, cardiac output is down and finally it will be going down only. So initially tachycardia, bounding peripheral pulses, warm extremities with hypotension, hyperapnea, augmentation, interventions like we have to do crystalloid bolus of 20 ml per kg, repeat until hemodynamically stable. First choice should be dopamine or norepinephrine, because norepinephrine is peripheral vasoconstrictor completely selectively. And cold shock, once the warm shock is not corrected, it may progress to cold shock, tachycardia, poor peripheral pulses, diminished pulses, hyperapnea, altered mentation. Crystalloid bolus of 20 ml per kg, repeat until hemodynamic stable. Early inotropic support with dopamine or epinephrine might be required. Echocardiography might be useful to guide the therapy because central venous pressures will alter rapidly. Cardiac output and systemic vascular resistance fall down because we are not treating warm shock or cold shock, and finally they are progressing very badly. Tachycardia, diminished pulses, hypotension, hyperapnea, altered mentation, so comatose child. So we have to try all this, whatever we have discussed, but there is no exact therapy for this. If we are not treating properly, antibiotic is also very important. We should start it early. What is the goal of shock treatment? So what goal is, oxygen is not going to tissues, we already know. So we have to optimize oxygen content of the blood by increasing, by giving oxygen from outside, by increasing circulation, increasing cardiac output, improving volume and distribution of cardiac output, reducing oxygen demand by resting the patient, lying him supine, and other metabolically active things should be dealt with. Correcting metabolic derangements. If we don't correct metabolic derangements, it may cause increase in oxygen demand also. So treatment, overall goal is normalization of tissue perfusion and hemostasis by airway management, secure and the patent airway, oxygen administration with 100% FiO2 if required in case of, except in some cases of cardiogenic shock. Breathing should be taken over by decreasing the work of breathing, intubation, mechanical ventilation may be required. Circulation, we have to improve cardiac output by inotropes, ensure adequate preload, fluid should be given judiciously. And how, after give lot of fluids and fast if there is hypotension. Then give more up, some more up to 200 ml per kg may be required. Reassess after each intervention, each step you have to reassess. You should not continue to go on giving fluids and all these things, okay? Pay attention to hepatomegaly, jugular venous distension, occurrence of rales, worsening, respiratory distress. If your patient is not responding to fluid, reconsider your diagnosis, okay? Because it may not be a fluid response to shock, it may be something else. We should be thinking of it. Once you reach 60 ml per kg of fluid bolus, consider starting vasoactive infusion. Don't delay it. Okay. Treatment 3 is derangements, correction of metabolic abnormalities, glycemia, hypocalcemia. Etiology specific management. Do not delay antibiotic for any reason if you suspect septic shock. Within the first 15 minutes, antibiotic should be going inside the body of the child if you suspect septic shock. Source control should be there, because if some infection, if you identify, you have to clean it, and source control should be done. Consider transfusion of PRBC if anemic. Assess efficacy of treatment. We have to always assess at each step how you are treating the child. Blood pressure, if it is normal or not. We have to increase fluid or inotropic support. Quality of central and peripheral pulses. Is it strong? Distal pulses are equal to central pulses or not? We have to reassure, recheck. And skin perfusion, warm with capillary refill time 1 to 2 seconds. Mental status, whether it is normal or not. Urine output more than 1 ml per kg per hour. And once effective, circulating volume is stored. Okay. Sepsis, high mortality despite improvements. Okay. So first dose of antibiotic should be given immediately within 15 minutes of shock management. Okay. This database is showing 4.2% in all corners and 2.3% in previously healthy and 7.8% in chronically ill. Okay, mortality is very high with septic shock. Guidelines are not effective unless protocols are driven. Early intervention is crucial in this. Every hour spent without reversing the shock increases the odds ratio of mortality. So we should not delay the treatment at any cost in septic shock. Okay. So these are the microorganism which is opsonized and attached to the leukocyte, macrophage, and endothelium, and then activation of all these pathways finally leading to organ dysfunction, immune dysregulation, hormonal alterations, metabolic changes, myocardial dysfunction, microvascular dysfunction, epithelial dysfunction, coagulation activation, and finally sepsis and multi-organ failure and death. Okay, so SIRS is systemic inflammatory response syndrome. Sepsis, severe sepsis and septic shock. Nowadays this definition are mildly altered, so we should be knowing about SIRS, sepsis, severe sepsis and septic shock. So Sirs, is temperature more than 30 degree centigrade or less than 36 means hyperthermia or hypothermia? More than 38 degree centigrade or less than 36 degree centigrade? Heart rate more than 90, respiratory rate more than 20, PaCO2 values less than 32, WBC count less than 4000 or more than 12000 or 10% bands. Sirs, sepsis is sirs plus infection. It is inflammatory response along with infection. Severe sepsis is there is associated end organ damage with this sepsis. With septic shock is severe sepsis with hypotension. So whenever the child is coming with septic shock, it is very dangerous, and majority of them, if you don't treat properly, can progress to irreversible shock and completely die. Okay, early goal directed therapy is in the treatment of severe sepsis and septic shock is utmost important. Okay, after satisfying the SIRS criteria, we should be treating them properly with fluid resuscitation and inotropic support. So if you take, this is from Nelson, 0 minutes, recognize the decreased mental strength. This is nothing but recognition of shock. First thing is start high flow oxygen, because you have to reduce oxygen demand by giving oxygen from outside. Establish an intravenous or intraosseous access. Then within 5 minutes after establishing an access intravenously or intraosseously, start fluid bolus at 20 ml per kg isotonic saline or colloid, or up to 60 ml per kg can be given until perfusion improves or hepatomegaly develops, because fluid overload develops. Until that stage, we have to give fluids. Okay, correct hypoglycemia, hypocalcemia, begin antibiotics. So see, in the first within minutes only, here he is telling to start antibiotic, begin antibiotic, don't delay. Correct hypoglycemia, and these are metabolic derangement, shock not reversed. So in the after 15 minutes, if we are taking it as fluid refractory shock, we have to immediately start inotrope. Okay, start inotrope with dopamine at 10 mg per kg per minute or epinephrine if required. Both it should be started. Okay, and we should be assessing central axis. We have to obtain central axis, and airway is to be taken on by intubation, mechanical ventilation may be needed. Reverse cold shock by titrating central dop. Reverse warm shock by titrating central norepinephrine. If not reversed by 1 hour, catecholamine we have to take it as catecholamine resistant shock, and we have to begin hydrocortisone along with it. We have to think of absolute adrenal insufficiency. Okay, absolute adrenal insufficiency. And we have to start monitor central venous pressure and PICU. Here we have to shift. This is all within the emergency department. Once the catecholamine resistant shock, we have to shift to pediatric intensive care unit. Monitor central venous pressure in PICU, attain normal mean arterial pressure, central venous pressure, and central venous oxygen saturation more than 70% is required. Okay, so cold shock with normal blood pressure is one entity, cold shock with low BP is one entity, warm shock with low BP is one entity. Okay, so all these entities, if shock is not reversed with appropriate management, then it is called as persistent catecholamine resistant shock. It is not being reversed with whatever you are doing. So finally, we have to consider pulmonary artery PICO and catheterization, okay, into the pulmonary artery, and see the pressures, whether how the heart is working. And goal is improvement in cardiac index to more than 3.3 in between and less than 6 liter per minute per meter square. We have to maintain cardiac index between this one. Okay, still not reversed, that we have to take it. Heart and lungs are not functioning. We have to keep the child on ECMO support. I think you heard of ECMO, extracorporeal membrane oxygenation. So this already we have discussed. 5-15 minutes. In 5 minutes, important thing is fluid resuscitation with beginning of antibiotics. For 0 minutes, we have to begin oxygen and IV or IO access. 5 minutes, we should be giving fluid bolus, correction metabolic abnormalities, begin antibiotic. 15 minutes, we have to start start inotropic support along with fluids and take the airway. 15 minutes completed, we should be starting inotropes. Along with that, we may have to consider hydrocortisone if it is not responding to inotropes. After 60 minutes, we have to definitely shift the child into pediatric intensive care unit. Okay, definition of vasopressor means increases systemic vascular resistance and therefore BP, Inotropies increase the contractility of the heart and systrophe volume. Chronotropy is increase in heart rate. Lucitropy is increase in diastolic relaxation. And what is this? Stroke volume also will increase. Vasodilator means decreases systolic vascular resistance. Okay. And afterload. Inodilator is also same as vasodilator. Okay. Here if you take a drug, dopamine. Okay. Receptor is dopamine receptor, beta and alpha receptor. Okay. Action is chronotropy, inotropy, vasoconstriction. Dose is 3 to 20 microgram per kg per minute. Dopamine is beta receptors on the heart. Chronotropy, inotropy and vasodilation. Epinephrine, beta, both alpha and beta, it causes intense vasoconstriction, chronotropy, that is increase in heart rate, and inotropy, contractility also. Okay, 0.05 to 0.2 microgram per kg per minute. Norepinephrine, alpha, beta, vasoconstriction, chronotropy, inotropy. Okay, milrinone is PDE inhibitor, phosphodiesterase inhibitor. It causes vasodilatation, lucitropy, inotropy. Okay. And nitroprusside is a vasodilator and vasopressin is a vasoconstrictor which acts on vasopressor, vasopressin vascular receptors. Okay. This talk, we'll go to anaphylaxis, second session. Are you following? Hello? Are you following?
Yes, sir.
Okay, right. We'll start with anaphylaxis. So our objectives of this session is define hypersensitivity reaction, mention the type of hypersensitivity reactions, define anaphylaxis, mention the etiologic causes of anaphylaxis, explain the pathophysiologic mechanism, mention the signs and symptoms, demonstrate the first aid and diagnostic interventions. Okay, treatment and first aid. Hypersensitivity reaction, injurious or pathological immune response is called as hypersensitivity reaction. Hypersensitivity reaction may occur in two situations. First situation is response to foreign antigens may be dysregulated or uncontrolled, resulting in tissue injuries, one variety. Second is the immune response may be directed against our own body antigens, self antigens, as a result of failure of self tolerance. It is called autoimmune response, autoimmunity. And types of hypersensitivity reaction, we already know 1, 2, 3, 4. Type 1 is IgE mediated. It is also called classic allergy. Type 2 is antibody mediated. Type 3 is immune complex mediated. Type 4 is delayed hypersensitivity, delayed type of hypersensitivity. So what will happen in immediate hypersensitivity? IgE formation will occur. IgE immunoglobulin will be formed from plasma cells, which activates mast cells to release all the vasoactive amines from it. Antibody mediated is nothing but antibodies will be IgG and IgM mediates this response, and these immune complexes also will cause RBC lysis. Immune complex disease, this is IgG mediated. This immune complex deposition will lead to serum sickness. And delayed type of hypersensitivity, example of delayed type of hypersensitivity is our skin test, tuberculin skin test. Okay, it leads to activation of our CD4 helper cells and macrophages and finally release of cytokines there. Anaphylaxis, ana means without, phylaxis means protection. So anaphylaxis means without protection. Okay, if he is exposed to something, he has to get these symptoms. He will not have any internal protection. Okay, anaphylaxis is sudden severe allergic reaction that can be life threatening. So we should be handling it very cautiously, and it is an emergency. It can, if some child or some parents are telling you that my child is allergic to something, we should be very much cautious and we should not be advising them at any cost to use it. Okay, it is very dangerous. It can occur within seconds or minutes of exposure to something someone is allergic to, like maybe food, maybe injection or drugs, pharmacopy. So all these things should be avoided. Immunoglobulin E mediated one hypersensitive reaction resulting in release of potent chemical mediators, that is mast cells, basophils. Affected organs are respiratory, cardiovascular, gastrointestinal, dermatologic, clinical diagnosis and biphasic reactions. So what is the definition? Clinical criteria number 1, 2 and 3, any one is sufficient to call it as anaphylaxis. Criteria 1 is acute onset of an illness from minutes to several hours with involvement of skin and or mucosal tissue. Example, generalized hives, pruritus or flushing, swollen lips, tongue, uvula, and or at least one of the following, like respiratory compromise with dyspnea, wheeze, bronchoconstriction, and stridor, reduced peak expiratory flow rate, hypoxemia, reduced blood pressure or associated symptoms of end organ dysfunction like hypotonia, syncope and incontinence. And criterion 2 is almost similar, but the thing is, two or more of the following should be there: involvement of skin mucosal tissue, respiratory compromise and reduced blood pressure or associated symptoms. Persistent GI symptoms is added here. Criteria 3 is only reduced blood pressure after exposure to an allergen can be taken as anaphylaxis, okay, less than 5th centimeter. So already we have discussed this clinical criteria. So what are the etiology? First and foremost is a study on 266 patients on anaphylaxis found that food is the major inciting. So some children may be allergic to seafood, some may be allergic to soy protein, some may be allergic to egg, and some may be allergic to some other food additives. So we should be very much careful, because food, we don't know, we may go to some restaurant along with that child. The child may suddenly eat some things which his child should not eat in the restaurant. Immediately he will get anaphylactic. So we should always carrying adrenaline pen with that. Okay. And after food, idiopathic is the majority, 37%. Drugs are 20%. Exercise 7%. And latex, we usually use our gloves, no? Latex powder, latex gloves. So that gloves also can cause the reaction on our hands, hormones, insect bites. Insect bites are bee wasps. We already know honey bee or hornet. All this can cause dangerous anaphylactic reaction. So food like peanuts, major in Western world, peanuts. Okay, whereas some peanuts is this one, green peas also will be there, no? So that also will cause. So peanuts and seafoods and wheat, milk, soy, eggs, pharmacologic agents like antibiotic, penicillin, commonest, we already know. NSAIDs like aspirin, IV contrast agents for kidney contrast agents, and sting insects, this is yellow hornet and bee wasp, okay, all the ants, some ants can cause all these things. Latex, our powdered gloves, all these things can cause allergies and anaphylaxis. So what happens in pathophysiology? Exposure to allergen, whatever allergen may be, it is exposed. And what is happening here? This exposed allergen is coming and binding on a B cell initially for activation of what is called as T helper cell. Okay, they become some memory cells, and the same stimulation of IgE class switching in B cells. So what happened? The B cell is converted into a plasma cell. Plasma cell is which produce antibodies. IgE type of antibody secreted from plasmas. This IgE antibody secreted and which finally coming on sitting on mast cell. On Fc receptor of mast cell, this IgE is respond sitting, and mast cell is having all inside nonsense. All vasoactive amines, chemokines, cytokines, all will be there, which if released will lead to danger. So inside all these things are there, no? Second, that is first is sensitization. This occurred here. Second time, if same allergen coming and sitting and it directly releases IgE, IgE comes and large amounts of IgG comes and sits on mast cells and leads to the release of histamine release. Okay, repeat exposure to allergen will lead to massive release of mediators, cytokines. It thinks that it is protecting the against this and allergen, but it is in fact damaging our own. Now this immunity is causing damage in this way only to our against SARS-CoV also. Our immune system is fighting like this only. Okay, vasoactive amines and lipid mediators leading to immediate hypersensitivity reaction, and cytokines leading to late phase of reaction 6 to 24 hours after allergen exposure. Okay, understood. So mediators are vasoactive amines and lipid cytokines, two types. These vasoactive amines are really results in immediate hypersensitivity reaction within minutes, and cytokines leads to reaction in late phase reaction within 6 to 24 hours. Okay, immediate reaction is by vasoactive amines and late phase reaction is by cytokines. Skin, what happens on skin? Itching starts, flushing occurs, red color, and hives. If you see, this is looking like hive, urticarial hives. Some majority of food have seen also, and swelling. Okay, all this can occur on the skin. Eyes, itching. First, always eyes or skin itching starts, tearing, tears, red color. Okay, inflammation and swelling around the eyes. Nose also, sneezing, running nose, nasal congestion, swelling of tongue, metallic taste. Lungs and throat, difficulty breathing, coughing, chest tightness, wheezing in a child, increased mucus production, so more mucus is produced, throat swelling and itching. Change in voice or sensation of choking, okay? Heart and circulation, dizziness, weakness, fainting, rapid, slow or irregular heart rate, low blood pressure. Digestive system, abdomen pain, nausea, vomiting, cramps, diarrhea can occur. Nervous system, anxiety, confusion, sense of impending doom can occur. Okay, how do you diagnose? The diagnosis of anaphylaxis is based on symptoms only. Or history of previous exposure, and now if the child or parents are telling, now the child again ate the same thing and he got these symptoms, then immediately we should be treating him. That occurs suddenly after being exposed to a potential trigger. Always we should be thinking of differential diagnosis for anaphylaxis like a severe asthma attack, but heart attack is very rare in children, but in adults it is common. Panic attack and food poisoning. So think of severe asthmatic attack, panic attack and food poisoning in children. An increased amount of tryptase protein can be measured in a blood sample collected during the first 3 hours after anaphylaxis symptoms have begun. Tryptase levels are seldom elevated in food-induced anaphylaxis. So we can differentiate food-induced anaphylaxis and other types of anaphylaxis by tryptase levels. First aid management. First call for help. Okay, in emergency, call 108 here and 911 in other Western world. Inject epinephrine immediately. If they are having a pen along with them, we should be injecting epinephrine dose into the muscle, that is outer muscle of thigh, okay, outer aspect of thigh. Do CPR if the person is stopped breathing, and okay, we should initiate CPR. First aid, in first aid, position should be, place the patient in Trendelenburg position, so that what in anaphylaxis we already discussed, it is distributive shock, so blood may pool up in peripheries, so we should allow the blood to come to heart. So we are using gravity for this Trendelenburg. So foot above and head below. So some amount of blood will come to heart. Okay. So place the patient in Trendelenburg position. We have to establish an airway and maintain it if necessary. Give oxygen via nasal cannula as needed. Point, place a tourniquet above the reaction site to reduce the impact. Epinephrine, if available with injection, give it immediately. Start IV access to raise blood pressure immediately. What group of drugs are used? Epinephrine is the most common drug used. Help maintain blood pressure, antagonize the effect of released mediators like vasoactive amines. You already know, no, bradykinin, all these kind there, no. The, we have epinephrine will antagonize all those effects and prevent further release of mediators. Antihistamine is primarily effective against cutaneous effects only. It is not recommended in anaphylaxis. H2 receptor antagonists, they block the effect of histamine on H2 receptors. Bronchodilators like albuterol, they reduce the bronchoconstriction and it tries to increase bronchodilation. How do you prevent? Avoid the responsible allergen, food, drug, latex. Keep an adrenaline kit ready with the child, okay, and a label on it. Wear medical alert bracelets. Wherever the child is going, he should have a bracelet that he is a severe, having anaphylactic reaction to these drugs, and having small one, pacemaker, like some autism child, like anyone, medical band alert should be there on it. Anaphylactic to so-and-so, allergic to so-and-so medicines or drugs, okay? Venom immunotherapy is highly effective in protecting insect allergic individuals like bee, wasp, bite, or all those things. Okay, a 5-year-old male who has experienced a severe allergic reaction to shrimp in the past needs a CT scan with IV and oral contrast. What precaution should you take? Shrimp is something else, food allergy. The CT scan contrast is something else. So nothing is required, reassurance, there is no associated risk for a reaction between shellfish and a contrast. Okay, understood? We cannot extrapolate that he is allergic to something, he will be allergic to everything, nothing like that. You have been asked by a local school to provide recommendation about the use of self-injectable epinephrine for anaphylaxis. What is the best response you give regarding anaphylaxis? Okay. Epinephrine reaches higher plasma peak concentration in injected into the thigh rather than the arm. So always we have to advise to inject adrenaline into outer aspect of the thigh. Understood? In question number 3, 14-year-old male child who has seasonal allergies and moderate persistent asthma is currently receiving allergen immunotherapy. Today in clinic he received his usual allergen injection, but after 10 minutes he started coughing and complaining of dyspnea, okay, and throat swelling. On physical examination he exhibits moderate respiratory distress and has diffuse expiratory wheeze and auscultate, because but he developed what is called anaphylaxis. He developed no oropharyngeal edema noted. The vital signs are all stable. Of the following, most appropriate next action is to inject epinephrine. To prevent further problem, inject intramuscular epinephrine. Okay. Last question. A 10-year male child with a history of peanut allergy presents with diffuse itching and trouble breathing after eating a friend's candy bar that contained nuts during school lunch. At the nurse's office, the patient received intramuscular epinephrine with his EpiPen with symptom resolution. Emergency medical services was called and patient was brought to local pediatric emergency department about a 12-minute ride. On arrival to the emergency department, the patient is again complaining of itching with an urticarial rash on his chest, and as per emergency medical services, the patient began vomiting as they were pulling up the ambulance bay. Arrival vitals are stable except blood pressure is on the lower side. If you see 90, it is less, systolic blood pressure is less than 90, no, 10-year-old, so it is on the lower side, and narrow pulse pressure is there. Heart rate is 95, mild on the tachycardic side. Of the following, most appropriate action is, even though the child received a first dose of epinephrine in the nurse office, we should again give intramuscular epinephrine, start IV antihistaminic if required, and normal saline bolus and Zantac. Okay, understood? Anaphylaxis and shock. CR, someone can speak, no? We can end the session. It is already 9:58. Understood?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Attendance, ichara?
Yes, sir.
Okay.